Good evening and welcome to The Connection. How's everybody doing this evening? Good, good, and welcome to you all out there. If you would like to stand and worship this evening, or this afternoon, I guess, this evening, if you'd like to stand and worship, you can, and if you want to stay seated, you're also able to do that, if you would like to, because this is a pretty long-winded song, and it's pretty up-tempo, so here we go. If you want to dance, you can do that too. Some people think you're distant, just some words on a page, that you're nothing more than fables handed down along the way. But I've seen you part the waters when no one else could pull me from the deep. That's who you are to me. Some people think you just live in cathedrals made of stone, but I know you live inside my heart. I know that it's your home. And I've seen you in a sunset and in the eyes of a stranger on the street. That's who you are to me. You're amazing, faithful, love's open door. When I'm empty, you fill me with hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are. Sometimes I have my doubts, I'm sure that everybody does. And I wonder when I stumble, am I still worthy of your love? But I know that I get stronger when I'm talking to you down on my knees. You're everything I need. You're amazing, faithful, love's open door. When I'm empty, you fill me with hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are to me. You're forever holy. You're the Lamb who is worthy, my forgiveness, my healer, the Messiah, my Redeemer. You're amazing, faithful, love's open door. When I'm empty, you fill me with hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are greater, higher, over and all. In your presence, Jesus, I stand in awe of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. Be seated. Would you pray with me, please? Good and gracious Heavenly Father, mighty God, we come before you today, Lord, thanking you once again for this opportunity to be in your house with your people. We ask, dear Father, that you would stir that Holy Spirit that lives inside of each and every one of us, dear Lord, that we might receive your words. We ask, dear Father, that you would be with us in this service, dear Lord, and be with us during our week. In Jesus' precious and holy name we pray. Amen. Every time I try to make it on my own, Every time I tried to stand and start to fall, and all those lonely roads that I have traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. There was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment of where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus. For a man who needs amazing kinds of grace, for forgiveness at a price I couldn't pay, I'm not perfect, so I thank God every day. There was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment of where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus on the mountain, in the valleys, in the shadows of the alleys, in the fire, in the flood. Always is and always was. No, I'll never walk alone. You are always there. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment of where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus. There was Jesus. There was Jesus. The point of weary, is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all it's stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. There ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free, and the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus, and let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, amen, amen. Who can wipe away the tears from broken dreams? dreams and wasted years and tell the past to disappear. Whoa, let me tell you about my Jesus and all the wrong turns that you would go and undo if you could. Who can work it all for your good? Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. There ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, amen, amen, amen. Who would take my cross to Calvary, pay the price for all my guilty? Who would care that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh, he makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. There ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, amen, amen. Hallelujah, 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 and let my Jesus change your life. Beautiful, beautiful. Well, where have you seen God this week? Oh, Rose got one.
Well, my neighbor girl, I've not known her when she was smaller. She was burning brush by what her mother said. Anyway, she either tumbled in the fire or her bike got burnt. I mean, she's burnt pretty bad. She's in the hospital in Springfield in the burn section. She's got 3 degree burns right now, and they drive from sin. But the doctor said she'd probably be there 6 weeks or longer.
Okay.
But so. This way that she's in lots of pain, and she's younger than I am, but things can happen. But you, with the fall works and burning when it's dry, you need to be pretty careful. I mean, she didn't know if she fainted or if she passed out. She hollered for her neighbors, and her neighbors didn't hear her, so she's just lucky that she's even alive.
Right, right.
But they got her up in Springfield.
Okay.
And they're trying, you know, the doctor going day by day.
Right.
It could happen to any of us.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. We'll pray for her. That's for sure. Just got word from Marilyn. She's not here this evening. Samantha King, that we've been praying for here, she has passed away. Just got word from her earlier with that. Has anybody else got one? Where have you seen God? A prayer request, a joy, a concern?
Well, this past week, I I went to take some flowers to a friend of mine in the nursing home, and my roses have started to bloom again when it's so dry. And anyway, one of the roses I picked was pink, but one of the petals was red. And she really, you know, of course liked that because it was unusual.
Yeah.
And her sister asked me, how did she get that rose to do it? And of course I said, God did it.
Absolutely.
And that's the way God is. He comes, he's kind of quiet at times, and he comes around in unusual spots and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
And we just have to look for him.
Absolutely, absolutely. That shows that uniqueness that God puts in all of us, too, for each and every one of us. Has anybody else got one?
Yes, every day is a special day. And I see God every day. And I was reminded of that this morning when Constance and I was reading our devotion. And the commentary was very nice. I won't read the whole commentary, just the last sentence. It says, when we seek God, our Creator will refresh us and show us that every ordinary day is something special.
Oh, absolutely.
And that
nice.
Spoke to me. It spoke to me again tonight as I was standing outside greeting everyone who came in, the smiles and the concerns on everyone's face. That meant a lot to me. And that last song, not the last song, but...
There was Jesus.
Yes. There was Jesus.
There was Jesus.
And that spoke to me. I'd never heard that song before. But those words, those phrases, was powerful. And that, I'd like to have a copy of that.
Amen. Amen. We can get you. We'll do that for
Google
you.
It.
We'll send. We know where to get it.
We know exactly how to get that one to you. We will do it. Okay. Some of those newer ones that we've been doing here, picked up here lately, they're very powerful, very impactful songs. They've got a lot of good deep meaning to them, and when we start to pick a song, that's what we go for. As the music team here, that's what normally we go for. We go for some deep meaning and powerful meaning stuff. We do contemporary music, but you can get a lot of different stuff. But we go for deep meaning and very powerful, moving stuff, and I like that stuff for sure. The old music had a lot of it in it, and so we look for it in the new music also. So thank you very much. I appreciate that. Has anybody else got one? Prayer request, a joy, a concern back here in the back, Mark?
Just happy I was able to come down south to be able to spend time with my mom. And
oh, amen, yes.
Company with her and safe travels, thankful for that. And we go to a church up in Independence, and we just helped them take care of their place when they were on vacation this week, and they paid us by being able to have their eggs. So it's just really cool though whenever we're all able to be like a family to help each other out, you know what I mean?
Oh, absolutely. Yes, that is a great one. And thank you guys. I appreciate you guys being here and coming. When you guys get down here, I enjoy always seeing you here when you're here. Has anybody else got one?
Andrew McFarland.
Linda, okay. Okay, well, Linda will do. Andrew McFarland is online. Andrew, hi, how you doing?
Andrew is requesting prayers for the family of Florian Toma, who passed away on Thursday.
Okay. Okay. Anybody else got one? Joy, concern, prayer request? Where have you seen God this week? Prayer request? Jim, retired pastor, Jim Gillum, had passed away. We had his funeral on Monday. Prayers for the family. Donna, Jim had been taking care of Donna. She had had a stroke and just trying to recover from that, and he had been taking care of her. So within that two-person family right now, you have the caregiver has passed away, and we had his funeral on Monday, and so she needs prayers and support, and she gets a lot of support. But yes, go ahead.
Yeah, Jim is a faithful pastor of the United Methodist Church and was retired.
Has been, yes.
And has been retired with his wife Donna for over 30 years. They are great encouragers. Both of them continue to be. They encouraged Michael and I when we left Prairie Chapel, and yep. Michael began out as a pastor himself. And so it's very sad. Jim had just been scheduled, actually, the following Monday. He passed Thursday before last, and he was scheduled this past Monday to go in for surgery for bypass, and he didn't make it. He was just a few days short of going in for his surgery. So, you know, Rose reminds us that things can happen to any of us,
yep,
any given day. So we ask that you also lift up Donna and their family in prayer as well.
Yep. Pretty devastating blow to lose an encourager and a mentor. Basically, he was for me, and he always encouraged. And boy, there's lots of these ups and downs. There's lots of hills and lots of valleys in the midst of it. But he was always encouraging and always moving you forward and trying to move you forward. He'd pick you up and dust you off and put you back on the path. Here we go. Come on. Don't give up. Don't give up. Never give up. And so that was one of his things, and he just kept on. And he was doing stuff at Prairie Chapel and involvement in the church all the way up until his last few days. And so Jim and Donna really need prayers. And so we lift them up in prayer. Jim's in a wonderful place right now. I'll guarantee you he is. So we'll lift them up in prayer. And has anybody else got anything? Anybody out there, Mark, online?
Just Andrew.
Just Andrew, okay. Andrew, it's nice to have you with us this evening. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll follow this by the Lord's Prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, mighty God, we thank you so much for everything that we see you do in our lives, dear Lord, and the work and the world around us. We ask, dear Father, that you would put your mighty healing hand upon this country, dear Lord, and upon our world, because we need you so badly. We ask, dear Father, that you would be with these prayer requests, dear Lord, that we have held up today in our midst, dear Lord, and the ones that were spoken and the ones that were unspoken, because you know our hearts and you know our minds. We ask, dear Father, that you would be with us as we come together to pray the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we come into this time of tithes and offerings and gifts, I would like to thank each and every one of you for the support of the United Methodist Church here in Bolivar, Missouri, and the United Methodist Church worldwide. We do a lot of stuff around the world and around the country. We're connected all over. We've got Ukraine stuff that goes on, and people in devastated areas we help through UMCOR. And we do a lot of stuff in our own community here in Bolivar. We're in the midst of the food pantry downtown. We partner with the Salvation Army. There's several different things that we're involved in. If you would like to, I'd like to thank you for your donations, your gift of money and monetary donations, and I'd also like for your to thank you all for your participation in the stuff that the Bolivar United Methodist Church does in our community. If you would like to, if you are part of our online ministry and you'd like to be involved, you can send your donations into the office. You can punch a button online. There are several ways that you can donate, and if you would like to be involved, get in touch with our secretary during the week, and she will put you in touch with somebody that you can get involved in community service outreach stuff. We've got a lot of stuff going on, and we would sure appreciate the help. If you would join me in the prayer of abundance. Oh, gracious, merciful, and abundant God, with thankful hearts, we give you our praise, our offerings, and all that we are. Let the world see your generous nature working through us. Make us a reflection of your love. Amen. Well, written in heaven. Well, last week we kind of hung out in Luke's gospel. We took a turn from Jesus and his focus on Jerusalem as he turned from his Galilean ministry, and it was coming down to the time of his crucifixion. He turned his eyes towards Jerusalem. And so we talked a little bit about the first little incident we had as he turned and started on this journey. And it's not really necessarily as much about the journey as the destination and the teaching within that. We're in Luke's gospel this week also. I don't know how I'm punching buttons. I've got my Bible underneath. Here we go. We're staying in Luke's gospel, and so we're going into chapter 10 this week. And we were in chapter 9 last week, and so we talked a little about Jesus and his walk and his journey, and he's trying to gather his followers and move them forward. And so we're in Luke's gospel, and we're chapter 10, verses 1 through 11, and then we're going to skip from 11 to 16 through 20. So 1 through 11 says this: After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them out two by two ahead of him in every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into the harvest fields. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the roads. When you enter a house, first say, 'Peace to this house.' If someone who promotes peace is there, your peace will rest on them. If not, it will return to you. Stay there, eating and drinking whatever they give you, for the workers deserve his wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and are welcomed, eat what is offered to you, heal the sick who are there, heal the sick who are there, and tell them the kingdom of God has come near to you. But when you enter a town and you are not welcome, go into the streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town we wipe from our feet as a warning to you.' Yet be sure of this, the kingdom of God has come near." Now, I'm going to stop right there, because what happens after that is verses 12 through 15 talks about Sodom and Gomorrah and some of these towns that God has completely obliterated. And we don't want to go into that now, do we? So let's talk about those first few verses. So in the first few verses, it says this: After the Lord appointed 72 others. Do you realize that in the four Gospels, out of the four Gospels, this is the only place in Luke's Gospel that it mentions the sending out of the 72? And there's some controversy within theology around this. In different scriptures, it says different things. Some of them says 72, and some of them says 70. And if you look at the scripture and you see the direction and what they are directing them to do, not take a purse, not take a bag, not take a sandals, it's almost exactly the same as when Jesus sent out the 12. Almost exactly the same. In Luke's gospel, when they start talking this, they talk this, and so as I was reading and doing my research this week, I've read a bunch of different stuff. Some theologians believe that this is symbolism. The symbolism of the 70 is there's 70, there were at that point in time, there were 70 Gentile nations. And so the sending out of the 70 was to open it up to the Gentile nations, is what some theologians say. And so as we look at this, you think, okay, that makes sense to me. And so, but when you think about it, really, in reality, they never went into a Gentile nation at all. So what had happened there, Jesus started out in Galilee. He spent his ministry right there around Galilee. Now he has turned his eyes towards Jerusalem. He has grabbed these 70 individuals doing the same exact thing as when he sent the 12 apostles out in front of him around Galilee and around those areas, and that ministry worked perfectly over here in Galilee in this area. Now, when we're putting our eyes towards Jerusalem, now we're sending 70 or 72, whichever you think is right, 70 or 72, and it doesn't really matter. You're sending them out in front of you just exactly like you did before to gather others to you. And so when this happened, and if we do this, if we think about this, what do we do today? If we are having a revival, what do? You just say, oh, well, we're going to have a revival, and we don't ever say anything about it, right? No, we advertise it. We send out people, and we send out flyers, and we try to make all this hype and bring others in. And Jesus, this model has worked throughout all generations. Jesus was using this model. He's sending them out, telling them that I'm coming. I'm coming to your town. I'm coming to your town. He gave them authority to heal the sick. He gave them the authority to cast out demons. They had some power. They had some power. And these 70 people were just 70 individuals just like you and I. If you turn backwards in your Bible and go to chapter 9, here's what it says. When Jesus had called the 12 together, and this is in Luke's gospel also, when Jesus had called the 12 together, he gave them power and authority to drive out demons and to curse diseases. And he sent them to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. Take nothing on your journey, no staff, no bag, no bread, nor money. Almost exactly the same, wasn't it? Almost exactly the same as when we're sending out these 72. And so we've blanketed all of the cities and the towns around Galilee. Now, since we have turned our eyes towards Jerusalem and we're on that last journey towards Jerusalem, this is Jesus' last time to go there. He sends 72 out among those cities as he was going through to blanket Judea, all of that area, as you're going towards Jerusalem. And so he's gathering a huge number of people as he's going. And so as we're looking at this piece of scripture, the Lord of the harvest, okay? The Lord of the harvest is who? God, right? That's God. But Jesus, as you see, the Lord of the harvest asked the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out the workers into the harvest fields. Jesus says, go, I am sending you. So he commands the authority right there. He is saying, okay, well, the Lord of the harvest is actually me. I'm God in the flesh. This is me, and I'm sending you, and here's what you're going to do. Do not take a purse, a bag, or sandals. That's pretty much having to rely on God, aren't you? You're pretty much having to rely on God and His caring for you when you go into a town and you start talking to people and you haven't got a bag, you haven't got nothing, you got no money, you got anything. You can't even rent a room. Ain't happening. You got to rely on the grace God has given to others to reciprocate to you. And buddy, that's tough. I don't know that I could do that. I haven't got no gas in my car. I haven't got no money. I haven't got no bread. I haven't got anything. I have to rely on you to feed me, to give me money. It says, do not take a purse, and do not greet anyone on the road. That one right there, when I got to that, I went, huh? Why not? Well, when you start researching this, this is how this works. In that area, in this time period, in this time frame and context, these journeys took day after day after day after day. When you started on a journey with a camel or a donkey or just walking, those journeys took quite a while. You just didn't jump in your car and your Hummer and spin on down there and be there in 15, 20 minutes. That didn't happen that way. These journeys took a while. So if they would meet others on the road, if the people would go out and they would meet others on the road, what they did is they talked. And they said, well, I'm going this way, and we're going down here to do this, and that person's going this way, and they're going down here to do this. Why don't we stop and share a meal together? Why don't we just hang out, just connect with one another, and talk about whatever we want to talk about? And they would get together, and they would spend the evening together, and they would sit around the fire, and they may sing, and they may do a whole bunch of different things. They may talk about God. They may talk about whatever. But they spent time together, the point being. Jesus made a sense of urgency out of this. Don't greet anyone on the road. We have a sense of urgency. We want you to go ahead and get to these towns and spread this word. We want you to keep on going. We don't want you to camp out with these folks over here overnight and hang out with them and then go to the town. We want you to keep moving. Don't greet anybody on the road. So that's what he meant by that. Sense of urgency in it. Because he got some urgency in his voice because we're headed towards Jerusalem. We have our focus set on this journey and on this destination. Let's go on to the next part of this. Verse 16 says this. Whosoever listens to you, listens to me. Whosoever rejects you, rejects me. But whosoever rejects me, rejects him who sent me. The 72 returned with joy and said, Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name. He replied, I saw Satan fall like lightning from the heavens. I have given you the authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your name is written in heaven. Beautiful. So when I got to that, I was like, okay, well, here we go. And so we get some symbolism around this one too. So it starts out like this. Whosoever listens to you, listens to me. And whosoever rejects you, rejects me. Yeah, okay. If you're speaking through that Jesus Christ is Lord and the kingdom of God is coming near, you need to be listening to that. The 72 returned with joy, Because apparently they had a whole bunch of people that were listening to what was going on. There had been some hubbub around all this for a long time. I mean, Jesus had been preaching and in the Galilean area for a long time, and now he's headed towards Jerusalem. He's spreading the word, and they're spreading the word, and they've heard about him. News travels fast in a small town, in a small area, and it's not a real big, huge area at all. Said, Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name. He replied, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I was like, wait a minute. Okay, hang on. Where'd he go there? Luke says, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. And so when you get to digging and get to researching around this, this is a symbolism from Jesus Christ, symbolizing Satan's defeat. Coming defeat. It's symbolizing Satan's coming defeat. He's feeling pressure. Satan is feeling pressure from the defeat that is inevitable when Jesus gets to Jerusalem and is hung on the cross. And I was like, wow, I never really knew that. And I've read over that scripture a whole bunch of times, and every time I hit it, I go, what? He fell like lightning from heaven. I just don't understand that, because he's already been cast out. And so you get three or four things going on in your head, and you go, why? And then you go, oh, well, just forget it. No, I don't just forget it no more. I dig for it, and I make sure I know what it is. Now, this is symbolism. Jesus throws a little symbolism out there, too. And I'm like, okay, well, here we go then. So we got this piece. Lord, even the demons submit to us. He replied, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all power of the enemy. Now, I don't believe that I would go out and put a bunch of snakes in a pit and trample around in them just to prove a point. Now, do you? No. There has been people that tried it, though. And there is people that still will try it. But Jesus, here again, this is symbolism of the evil that is in the world, all of the stuff that is around us day by day, the demons and the stuff, the evil that is possessed within all kinds of areas in our life and in our world, and it's everywhere. Snakes and scorpions. How often do you see a snake or a scorpion unless it's surprising you? There it is. They're always where you don't really realize that they are, and they always surprise you. And that's how evil is. It sneaks up on you. It doesn't come at you face to face. It comes at you from behind or from beside or from some other angle that you're not really ready for, because that's how it gets you. That's how Satan gets hold of you. He takes you when you're least expecting or when your guard is down. That's what the symbolization of these snakes and scorpions are, symbolizing the evil that is in the world that is attacking us day by day. And so when I got down to the rest of this, I said, okay, well, overcome all powers of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. Boy, that's beautiful, isn't it? Nothing will harm you. Jesus has given us, as disciples of Christ, has given us the power and authority over all evil. We have a choice. We're able to make that choice, each and every one of us. We don't have to choose evil. We can choose to turn from evil. We don't have to choose any of those things. We can turn from them. It's not like we're have to go that way. It's a choice for us. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your name is written in heaven. And when I got there, I was like, oh, okay, rejoice that your name is written in heaven. How do you know that? How do you know that? When we accept Jesus Christ into our heart, our name is written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. It tells us in several different places. And so, boy, do you see all these tags? Do you see all these tags in this Bible here? Every one of those tags is something about the books of heaven. Because if you think about the book, the Lamb's Book of Life, where your name is written, Art, and my name is written down, and we know where we're going. We know when that book is open over there, my name's going to be there. It's going to be there. And how I know that my name is going to be there is because of this. I've repented from my sin, step number one. I've accepted Jesus Christ into my heart. He is my Lord and Savior. He guides my every step and my movement in this life. I try to follow God's law best I can. And when I fail or I stumble, that repentance don't only come one time. It comes every time. Every time. And so I got kind of hung up on the books written in heaven. And so I decided that I was going to see how many books I thought were there. So what I did is I went all the way back to where we talk about the very first time that we talk about a book. And if you go all the way back to Exodus, and here's where it is. They have made themselves gods of gold. Talking about the children of Israel, the golden calf. This is Moses. But now I plead with you, forgive their sin. But if not, then blot me out of the book you have written. The first mention of the book. Okay, now we got to start. There's one book. When you jump on over to Daniel, here's another spot. This is Daniel, and it's a dream. As I looked, thrones were set in place, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothes was white as snow, and his hair was white like wool. His throne was flaming with fire, and its wheels were all ablaze. A river of fire was flowing, coming out from before him. Thousands upon thousands attended him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated, and the books were open. Now, this tells me that there's more than one book. It's not just the Book of Life. It tells me that there's more than one book. So, you know me, I'm going to keep digging. We jump on over to Malachi, and this is what it says there. Then those who feared the Lord talked with each other, and the Lord listened and heard. A scroll of remembrance was written in his presence concerning those who feared the Lord and honored his name. On the day when I act, says the Lord Almighty, they will be my treasured possessions. I will spare them just as a father has compassion and spares his son who serves him.
another book, Book of Remembrance. It tells us, Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians this, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due us for the things done while in this body, whether good or bad. So we talk about righteousness, sinlessness. This is not a one-time thing, folks. This is absolutely not a one-time thing. You don't repent of your sin, and from there forward, your sins are all forgiven. That is not the way this works. We have to humble ourselves in front of the Lord. We have to realize that we have sin in our lives. We have to repent. It's an ongoing process. Just like this journey that we have started out with Luke. We are starting out as Jesus is starting his journey towards Jerusalem. We're all, each and every one of us, are on a journey. And this journey is a process. Jesus went through the journey. We're going through the journey, each and every one of us. But Jesus is with us. There was Jesus. There was Jesus. There was Jesus. We see Jesus in all different things. We see Jesus in each other. We see Jesus as we help one another, as we move along through this life. The 72 went out. How'd they go out? They went out two by two. They didn't go out by themselves. They went out together. So we have support of one another. We love one another. We care about one another. That's what our Christian, that is all, that's what our DNA is all about. That's what who we are. That's who Jesus taught us to be. But the main point is my name is written in a book over there. And one day, those books will be open and my name will be read. I'll have to answer for the things I haven't repented for, but I also get to receive the rewards on the other side. And they're immense. They're immense. And if there's one out there, that is not, and does not know that your name is written in that book, it's very, very simple. Repent of your sin. Ask Jesus Christ into your heart. He loves each and every one of us. And he is waiting with open arms. As we come into this time of communion, this is kind of what it's all about. Jesus communing with others. What he does with us. I would like to let you all know that this communion table is not the United Methodist Church's table. This is God's table. And everyone is invited. Everyone is invited to sup with Christ at his table. Each and every one of us. And on the night that Christ sat with his disciples, he took the bread and he broke it. And he blessed it. And he passed it to each one of his disciples. And he said, here, take and eat. For this is my body broken for you. And when the meal was finished, he took the cup. And he raised it. And he blessed it. And he passed the cup to each one of his disciples. And he said, here, take and drink. For this is the blood of the new covenant poured out for the sins of many. That's for you, and that's for me, that's for us. And as long as you do this in remembrance of me. Over 2,000 years have passed since that moment, and we are still doing it in remembrance of me. of Jesus Christ's mighty acts on the cross of Calvary that saved us, that gave us this chance of eternal life, that defeated an enemy. I seen him fall like lightning from the heavens, it said. He knew that his defeat was imminent. And Jesus went to the cross of Calvary to defeat Satan and to hand us this grace, undeserving grace that we are blessed with, this eternal life that we've spoken of. Art, would you come and help me with communion, please? would like to read one more verse, well, maybe two more verses before we leave. Revelation chapter 3, verse 5 says this: "The one who is victorious will, like them, be dressed in white. I will never," this is Jesus speaking, "I will never blot out the name of that person from the book of life, but I will acknowledge that name before my Father and his angels." Isn't it good to know that we have an advocate, that we have Jesus Christ that backs us to the Heavenly Father and to his angels? He sees you, he knows you, and he loves you. Would you stand?
Some say don't give up and hope that your good is good enough. Head down, keep on working. If you can earn it, you deserve it. Some say push on through. After all, it's the least that you can do. But don't buy what they're selling. Couldn't be further from the truth. What if I were the one to tell you that the fight's already been won? Well, I think your day's about to get better. What if I were the one to tell you that the work's already been done? It's not good news, it's the best news ever. Some say don't ask for help. God helps the ones who help themselves. So press on, get it right, otherwise get left behind. Some say he's keeping score, so try hard, then try a little more. But hold up, if that were true, explain to me what the cross is for. What if I were the one to tell you that the fight's already been won? Well, I think your day's about to get better. What if I were the one to tell you that the work's already been done? It's not good news, it's the best news ever. So won't you come? Come all you weary and you burden, you heavy laden and you hurting, for all of you with nothing left, come and find the one to tell you that the fight's already been won. Well, I think your day's about to get better. What if I were the one to tell you that the work's already been done? It's not good news, it's the best news ever. Best news ever. It's not good news, it's the best news ever. Best news ever. It's not good news, it's the best news ever.
Brothers and sisters, you have some good news. go out and spread that good news all across your area, to your neighbors, to your family, to your friends. Good news, the good news. Jesus Christ came to this earth, died on a cross to save us, to offer us that eternal life. Good news. That's the best news ever. Would you pray with me, please? Good and gracious Heavenly Father, mighty God, we come before you, Lord. Oh, thank you for sending your Son Jesus to us to set that example, to show us what we need to do and how we need to live. We ask, dear Father, that you would go with us now from this place, dear Lord, and be with us and stir our spirit, dear Lord, and move us in the direction you would have us to go. In Jesus' precious and holy name we pray. Amen. As you carry the light of Christ out into the world this week, make sure you realize someone is watching you. Thank you for being here. Thank you.